Second, everybody.
What are you eating now?
Okay, welcome to the Lovecraft eZine video talk show. Today is Sunday, August the 2nd. We do this every Sunday at 6 o'clock Eastern. And just in case you are watching this later and you ever want to watch it live, you can do that. Just go to the Lovecraft eZine website on Sundays at 6 p.m. Eastern. Today, our guests are author Gemma Files and filmmaker Len. Can you say your last name for me? Because I know I'm going to say it wrong.
No, it's okay. LoBiondo.
LoBiondo, okay. Gemma is, let me see, I wanted to write down some stuff because she's written so much I don't want to forget all of this, but her story, The Emperor's Old Bones, won the International Horror Guild's 1999 award for best short fiction. You got a couple collections out, I think. Kissing Carrion, The Worm in Every Heart.
Yeah.
And quite a lot of other stuff, I believe.
Yeah, I tallied it up last year and I discovered that I had written over 87 short stories over a 25-year period, so.
Wow.
And, a trilogy of books, novels, the Hexlinger series.
Yeah.
And my new novel is coming out in November. It's called Experimental Film.
Yeah. What's that about?
Well,
like about experimental films.
If you've ever read my story, the story that I wrote with my husband, called Each Thing I Show You Is a Piece of My Death. It's set in the experimental filmmaking community of Toronto, and one of the characters from that makes a cameo appearance in this story. And again, it is about film history. It's about haunted films. It's about the way that one person's work of art can become a sort of horrible door through which something very large and malign can peer at you from outside of space and time. All that.
Oh, wow. When did
can't
you say
wait.
That?
Sorry?
Go ahead, Joe.
I said, I can't wait. I just finished this week.
Ah.
And
which one was that, Joe?
It's The Absolution of Roberto Estes Lang by Nicholas Rumbies. It's brilliant. I hate this guy. People should not be able to write this good. Or else they should give me 10% of their talent. A book about film.
Yeah.
Let me just cut in real quick and we'll get back to Gemma in about 60 seconds here. I should say that Len, we're going to talk to Gemma for a while first and then we're going to talk to Len here. And Len is the guy behind the short film Reaver, which has quite a few Lovecraftian themes, and I really, really enjoyed it. It's free to watch on Vimeo. And I should also say that we're giving away to the live viewers a really cool Cthulhu bank, which I pictured on the website today. And then Matt has a couple of books to give away.
Sure. This is the really wonderful... This is
go back.
This is Jeffrey Thomas's best work. That's saying quite a lot. I really enjoyed the short novel called Subject 11. It turns out I have two copies of the limited edition, so I'm giving away copy number 121. It is signed by Jeffrey Thomas.
Oh, wow, that's a great prize.
It's a great prize, so if you do get it and read it, it'd be nice for you to go review it for him.
Wait, you're going to give away copy 121 of Subject?
Yeah. Which is 11 squared, I know.
Okay. All right.
All right.
As long as I'm not the only math geek here.
Okay. Then this is called Years of a Mad God. I will say that this is the first part of a three-part series by Brent Nichols. It's supposedly a steampunk Lovecraftian adventure. So this may get you hooked and make you want to buy the rest of it. Well, you'll have to go buy the rest of it because this is all I got.
It's a gateway drug. That's what it is.
Right, exactly.
So, thanks, Matt. And we'll give those three prizes away to viewers later on in the show. So anyway, back to Gemma. Experimental film.
Yeah.
I don't want to push Lovecraftian concepts where none exist, but that sounds a little bit Lovecraftian to me.
Yeah, it's been very funny for me. Over the last 5-6 years, I've become I've drifted into being known as someone who can write Lovecraftian fiction. And it was never, I admire Lovecraft a lot, but it was never something that I thought was hugely in me. And then I realized, oh, wait, no, there are resonances that people pick up on. It's not so much that you have to be writing mythos. It's not so much that you have to be name-checking everybody from Cthulhu to Dagon. But there are particular themes that, yes, indeed, do resonate pretty much through most horror, but also through most of the stuff that I'm interested in and most of the stuff that I produce. So, I think it does have a Lovecraftian thing to it. One short story that I wrote early on in this process for, I believe, Lovecraft Unbound for Ellen Datlow was a story called Maria Knox, which was about an old god, a small god, a goddess.
That's a great story. I love that
very
one.
Much. And this is kind of picking up on that theme. This is kind of picking up on the idea of an old, dead, forgotten goddess who is viewed through the lens of film.
In that story, you had a goddess who was sort of a mixture of pagan beliefs and Christianity.
Yeah, Byzantine.
Was that based on anyone? Because I've known of similar versions of the Virgin Mary.
Well, that got done a lot during the formative years of the church, and I've always been interested in that concept, the idea of pagan imagery and pagan iconography being subsumed to the uses of the church, in much the same way that the Romans used to come in and grab people's gods up and put them in their pantheon. And, you know, they wouldn't forbid you to worship your own gods, but they'd just be like, well, yeah, but you also have to worship our gods. And that was more difficult for the church, obviously. So the easiest way that they could go about that, smoothing things over with people they were trying to convert to Christianity, would be to take the iconography of pagan gods and goddesses and feed them through the church. I've been interested in that for a really long time, and I continue to be interested in it. I love archaeology. I love religious history. I love all that stuff.
There is an Aztec version of that called Santa Muerte, which
recently
popped up in True Detective.
Yes. Yeah, Santa Muerte is a wonderful version of that. It's a wonderful example of that. Also the Orishas being identified with the Catholic saints. That's a fascinating kind of use of that subsuming of the iconography. You know, sort of like, well, you don't want me worshiping these African gods, so I will call them by the names of Catholic saints, and then that'll be fine. Basically, the story begins with a person who's not me by any stretch of the imagination, even though she is a former film history teacher and film critic who lives in Toronto and has a child with special needs and lost her job around the same time that he was diagnosed. unlike me, however, she hasn't been writing fiction for 25 years, so when that happens, she just downward spirals into like a huge font of despair. And the only thing that she can kind of hang on to is reviewing things for almost no money, often very underground things. And while reviewing a showcase of experimental film, she realizes that one of the films in this showcase has a film inside of it. This guy, the guy who put it together, is well known for sampling old films and just kind of going, yeah, isn't this great? Neat imagery. Where'd I find it? Oh, I don't know. I taped it from somewhere. He used to work at a film archive. He actually got fired from there because he would constantly do that. And by looking at this piece of somebody else's film stuck inside of his film, she's able to go, you know what, I think possibly there might have been a woman making films in Ontario around the same time as Georges Méliès that nobody knows about. If I can find out who that woman is, and I can write a book about her, I can, you know, make a documentary about her, suddenly I will be somebody, and I won't have to just be this depressed person with this kid who won't talk to her except in limericks and bits and pieces picked up from TV shows and stuff like that. Echolalia, as they call it. So I took my own life and I kind of ran it through that filter. But what I came up with hopefully is something that A, is a standalone piece of horror, and B, is something far beyond just me going, oh yeah, here are my guts. Blech. That's my hope.
I was looking at your bibliography and I noticed you were published in Northern Frights.
I was, yeah.
Which was edited by a good friend of mine, Don Hutchinson, who was he's now a retired documentary filmmaker.
Yeah, Don's amazing. Don really was like the beginning of the weird scene in Toronto in a lot of ways. Like a lot of us who went on to form the nexus of cheesing publications really met each other by working with Don.
So did you get into horror was your interest in film, or was it a combination of it?
I think I was always interested in the spectrum of horror. I think I was always interested in horror culture because I read at a very early age and I was attracted to dark stuff very, very early on. Tanith Lee, grim fairy tales, all sorts of weirdness. One of my favorite books when I was a kid was this thing called a compendium called The Book of Weird by Barbara Nint Byfield. And every page was just like a whole bunch of really strange stuff from all around the world. I think I was always interested in it. But then when I became a little bit older, yes, it began to coalesce around film. And for a while, I thought that I would be a filmmaker. For a while, I thought that I would write films or direct films and ran into trouble almost immediately trying to get this across to people. When I'd say, I want to make horror films, they'd be like, oh, like Friday the 13th? And I'd be like, no, like Hellblazer, or Hellraiser, rather. That was another thing that fed in there, was Vertigo Comics. But, and they'd be like, I do not see the difference between these two things. And I'd be like, there you go.
You're like, conversation's over.
Sorry?
You were like, conversation's over at that point.
Yeah, exactly. When I began reviewing films, I met this guy, Bruce Kirkland, who used to work for the Toronto Sun, and he said, I remember you. When you were 13 or 14, you wrote us a letter complaining about my review of, what is it? God, it's gone right out of my head. Clive Barker's second film, the one that's based on Cabal.
Nightbreed.
Yes. My complaining about my review of Nightbreed. And I said, well, yeah, I really feel that you should recuse yourself from reviewing things like that because you obviously hate horror, Bruce. I've read almost all of your reviews and you obviously hate it. And he said, no, I'm very offended by that. I watch horror movies. I said, what was the last horror movie you saw that you liked? He said, Spawn. I said, there you go. So for a while, during my career as a film reviewer, I was probably the only person in Toronto who gave the kind of depth that I would hope that people would give to horror and weird film and cult film, stuff like that. And often I would begin, my reviews of mainstream films by saying, listen, I have to tell you, this is not what I'm into, but those who like this sort of thing may find this the sort of thing that they like. Went pretty well for about 9 years, but then the place that I was working for basically forced me out because I was way too old at the ripe old age of 34 to write for hot, hip, young people. And then I began writing more often, but also teaching film history and screenwriting and stuff like that. First at a place called the Trevis Institute, and then at another place called the Toronto Film School.
I noticed too that you have written for TV a bit.
Yep, that's true. The Hunger, which was a show which was put together by Tony and Ridley Scott. It was an erotic horror anthology produced for Showtime in the States out of Montreal. Out of Telescene in Montreal. And basically they needed a certain amount of Canadian content, so they ended up optioning 5 of my short stories and adapting them into episodes. And I got to adapt 2 of those myself, so that was a really interesting experience.
That's awesome. Did you like the final result?
I did, actually. One of them, the 2 that I was involved with directly, I actually liked a lot. Of the other ones, I'd say I like one of them better than most of the others. and at least one of them was, it was a very funny story because, it was an erotic horror anthology, right? So very, very straight, very, very heteronormative. Mm-hmm. And right at the beginning, I sent them a whole bunch of stories that had sex in them, and immediately got back basically an email that said, yeah, we can't take half of these because they're too gay. They're way too gay. Like guy type gay. Like guys getting it on type gay. And I was like, all right, well, you know, you're lost.
They were fine with 2 women, not 2 guys?
Yeah, they were fine with 2 women, but not 2 guys. And they weren't even fine with 2 women until the second season. But, so they ended up optioning one of my stories that had no sex in it whatsoever. But I guess their assumption was that possibly they could de-age one of the characters and make the other character a little less repulsive and have the 2 of them have sex at some point, and it would be fun, heteronormative sex. The person that they assigned to that as a director was a guy who walked in and said, okay, so I'm interested in doing this, but I got to tell you, I just came out. So do you have anything that's gay? And they were like, no, we don't. And he was like, okay, well, I'll just take this and I'll just rewrite it, all right? So he rewrote that entire episode, oversaw the rewriting of that entire episode, made it a completely different story, which was indeed gay all the way. I remember sitting in front of my computer and thinking, wow, you just made an end run, which was pretty funny. All you had to do was, like, buy a gay story from me.
Yeah, ironic.
Yeah, it was pretty funny. It was very ironic. But that's Hollywood for you.
Joe, you have some...
Yeah, I'm awake.
Yeah. No, I meant, do you have some questions for Gemma, or...
Oh, no, I'm just listening. I'm interested, real interested in this new book. Flicker is one of my favorite novels.
Throat Sprockets is one of my favorite novels.
I'm sorry?
Describing of experimental film?
Tim Lucas.
Joe, what she's describing of her upcoming book, is it just me or does that sound a little bit echo of some King in Yellow themes or... Somewhat.
I don't know. You could tie anything into it. Depends what she wanted to bring to the table.
One of my favorite
writers, I'm real interested is what she brought, you know, sewed into this thing.
Yeah. The idea of a piece of artwork which infects your mind is definitely a Robert Chambers kind of thing.
Yeah.
But I've seen it in a bunch of other places as well.
I mean, the trope isn't necessarily Chambers. It certainly can be utilized in that manner, but it doesn't have to be.
Yeah. But certainly another thing I was thinking of was John Carpenter's Cigarette Burns.
Which I adore, yeah.
Yeah.
Which is hella Lovecraftian.
Really? Because I see it hella King and Yellowin.
Yeah, I do too.
You've kind of got both things going on, and also it has horrifying angels, which I'm very partial to. but there's just so much to like about that episode. So much to like about that.
Yeah, I couldn't think of the name of the of that episode when you were talking about your book earlier. But yeah, I that crossed my mind as well. Yeah. When the experimental film comes out?
November.
November. Okay.
In the new novel, mm-hmm. I assume you've created a lot of your own experimental film for the book. But
I also reference films that exist.
Yeah, I was going to say, is there a lot of stuff that we all know, you know,
It depends on what your background is, whether you all know it. This is the thing, you know. I remember showing bits of it to friends of mine beforehand, and some of them would be like, yes, I totally know about this stuff, and other people would be like, I have no idea what you're talking about. And it was a real struggle throughout the thing to balance how much you would have to describe the backbone of experimental filmmaking in order to give people a context for what I was talking about.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Who's publishing that, Gemma?
eZine.
Okay.
eZine Publications here in Toronto.
Inevitably, people are going to ask, will there be a Kindle edition too?
Yeah, definitely. Okay. They always have really good ebook editions.
Okay, good. I can't wait to read this. That sounds fascinating.
Oh, thank you. I'm hoping that it will change things for me, to be perfectly frank, because it's been an interesting trip. I was told for years and years, for like 15 years, that I needed to write novels, and the immediate cost-benefit analysis was not really obvious to me, because it's a lot of investment and not a lot of kickback, but it's certainly true that ever since I started to write novels, suddenly my name became far more recognizable than it was before. And what I'm hoping is that after the first wave of recognizability, which is mainly attached to the Hexlinger novels, that trilogy, then that I will move from being just the gay, black magic, Aztec gods, blood, horse opera, porno person, to straight up horror, so to speak, straight up horror. Yeah. because
could you talk a little more about Hexlinger?
Hexlinger came directly out of my id. It was very much me going, you know what, I'm not even going to make any concessions towards what I think is saleable. I'm just going to write what comes into my head and what interests me. And that's what came out of my head. Alternate version of the Wild West, where people randomly express into magicians so powerful they're like mutants. people who can make magic out of bullets and magic out of words and magic out of whatever it is that they're most attached to in terms of their individuality. And an Aztec Mayan goddess who picks one of these people to be her avatar and to marry. Unfortunately, he already has a boyfriend who's kind of annoyed about this. And things kind of go from there.
If I can get back to something you said what you were talking about just a minute ago.
Yeah.
What personally to you is success as a writer? I think different mm-hmm. writers would answer this differently, and I'm always curious.
I think for me, success as a writer falls under two rubrics. And the first one is, have you done everything that you can to bring what's inside your head onto the paper so that you recognize it and you're like, yes, I brought that to birth. It is exactly what I wanted it to be. But from the other point of view, it's about, can you create something that other people latch onto? Can you create something that is very evocative for other people? And what's fascinating is that sometimes the thing that you think you're creating is appealing to people for reasons that you had no idea that it would be appealing to people when you were writing it. There's a certain alchemical process, I think, that happens when you're putting something together. And often, for me, it's like the difference between not so much what happens and how it happens, but it's more like what happens and why it happens. Why do we end up where I know we have to end up? And it's those emotional layers that people kind of attach themselves to, and that I find absolutely fascinating. So if I can do either of those two things, I'm really happy, and if I can do them both at the same time, I'm ultra happy.
Go ahead.
Just to finish up what I was thinking about with the transition between the two types of books, what I like about experimental film is that it's very much more like my short fiction than it is like my long fiction thus far. And I've seen a kind of like two different audiences. You know, there are people who know me mainly for my short fiction, and there are people who know me mainly for my novels. And hopefully this will bring those two different audiences together.
Got a couple of audience questions. Kim wants to know, if you could write any character crossover you wanted, regardless of copyright, what would your dream crossover be?
Oh my God, my dream crossover. I am hugely, hugely fond of Reanimator, I must admit. And, you know, in fact, one of... a short story of mine that's being reprinted right now in a Steve Berman book called Daughters of Frankenstein is essentially my attempt to write a Reanimator pastiche involving two lesbian mad scientists who create a drug that that turns you as a side effect into a zombie. which is not what they were going for, but that's the way.
He's having a headache because you're you're anticipating the Animatrix.
Yeah,
I just have a whole novel based on that whole concept.
Yeah, exactly.
That started for the exact same reason for the exact same anthology.
Perfect.
The first 1,000 words were supposed to be going toward
for Daughters of Frankenstein.
Yes.
Cool.
And it just got out of control.
Yeah.
Now it's 140,000 words.
Well, again...
Did you steal this idea from Gemma again?
Again, this was complete id fuel. It was originally done for a little tiny series that was done by Kelp Queen Press called Loony Dreadfuls. Up here in Canada, we have a coin called a Loony, which is a $1 coin. These days, it would be a Toonie Dreadful. But because we also have a $2 coin. And basically, Sandra Castori, who operates Kelp Queen Press, said to me, write just the most idtastic thing that you can think of. And that's what came out. Blech. You know, lesbian Reanimator pastiche.
Right. We're okay.
Yeah, exactly. Also, sort of like Murder by Numbers.
So I will say this because that's kind of evocative, because Reanimatrix is Laura.
Ah, nice.
Okay, because, you know, when your murder victim comes back in Arkham, it's a whole different ball game.
Definitely.
So yeah,
I would start with Reanimator, and I'd go from there. There are like a million different other things that I'd love to cross over with that. At the moment, one of my big, big pleasures in life is The Walking Dead. So, Walking Dead crossovers are always good. But I'd really love to do like a steampunk Walking Dead crossover.
Hmm.
Okay.
Do you watch Penny Dreadful?
I do. That's the best thing ever.
what you've been saying your interests are, so that was a natural for you.
Well, you know, mashups and a kind of crossbreeding spirit, I think, is something that's become more and more interesting to me as I've gone along. I kind of grew up in the beginning of the first golden age of fan fiction in a lot of ways, you know, where people were perfectly fine with remix culture all of a sudden. You know, before that, it was like, yeah, yeah, you know, you play around with that stuff, but you can't actually let it touch your work. And now it's like, no, 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 do it. Do it. Take whatever you like and just stick it in a bowl. Go like that. Bake it up, see what comes out. So there you go. Sometimes what you like is Robert Aikman. Sometimes what you like is Reanimator.
I just threw up a little in my mouth.
Come on, you know that would be awesome.
Sure.
You know, speaking of Nightbreed, a few months ago you were talking about Nightbreed. It seems to me. That's the kind of characters that seem to really fascinate you. Can you talk a little bit about the kind of characters that you like to write?
I like terrible people. I like monsters. You know, monsters who know they're monsters to some degree. Monsters who embrace their monsterness. Paula Guran said something once about my fiction. She said, you know, these are people who are alone in the dark with themselves, and they know they're kind of the worst thing in there. And that's what interests me. I'm not that interested in normative horror. I'm not that interested in that version of horror which begins with going, well, things went wrong, but then they all got better, you know. Every once in a while, there's something like that that I end up liking. For example, say Poltergeist, you know, is still a big template, a big touchstone for me. But it seems very, one hesitates to say puerile, but it really does seem very young, kind of jejune, to stay at that level. I know that I'm not a nice person, and indeed very few people that I know are nice people per se. I think it's better to know yourself and get on with your life. In a lot of ways, what I write is me working through that.
What's a nice person?
It's a good question. You know, what is a nice person? You know, it's like, when I was writing experimental film, there'd be moments where I'd be like, wow, what am I going to look like at the end of this? That woman's not me, but at the same time, she shares so many of my qualities that I know that someone's going to look at that and go, you treat your son like that? Do you feel about your son like that? Have you had these thoughts? And I can say, yes, I have had these thoughts. I think anybody who has a child with special needs has had thoughts, very, very dark thoughts about guilt and about what the future is going to be like and about are things ever going to improve? What is my child's quality of life going to be like? Would it have been better for me to not have had a kid? All that. And yet at the same time, I know I love my son completely. And on that level, I'm a good mother. You know, I look after him. I make sure that he has everything that he needs. He knows he's loved. He's a wonderful, wonderful guy. Smart and funny, but he is who he is.
If he knows he's loved, speaking myself as a parent, and you make that real and your actions are behind that,
yeah,
you know, that's much of what is good parenting in my view. Speaking of nice people versus not nice people, or nice parents versus not nice parents, you know, there's so many parents that their kids aren't...
Yeah,
they don't look at their kids as a gift at all, you know, or with love at all. They're just sort of there, you know. I had sex, and this is what happened, you know.
Oh yeah, or you have some idea of what a child should be, and you want to, you know, you only acknowledge the kid when they fit into that.
Yes.
You know? And otherwise, it's sort of like, why are you not being this thing that I hoped that you would be? I feel kind of lucky in a way that I never got to have that. You know, I had that for like maybe a year and a half. And then after that, it was like, well, let's get on with it. I know I'm angry. I know I'm selfish. I know that I have a lot of dark things inside of me. But at the same time, a very long time ago, I got a tattoo on my shoulder, which is a quote from Flaubert. which is, be neat and orderly in your life like a bourgeois so that you may be creative and violent in your work. And to me, that's where it all goes. You know, sort of the worst things I discover in myself, the more there's a part of me that's like, oh, good, I can stick that on the page.
Right, right. Maybe, but, and I know we're getting off topic a little bit, off of your work, but it may be the difference between, some of the difference between good people and bad people, or whatever word we want to use, nice, is we've all got dark things inside of us, but it's the people who feel bad about them and want to prevent that coming out, for lack of a better term, or don't want that to control them, are the better people.
Well, that's the hope.
Yeah, true.
You know,
Mike, you that story I wrote for your King in Yellow issue, the first act. That's me exercising that demon. And it's based on what something that really happened is my wife introduced me to this guy and she said, you'll love him. He's so much like you. And he was. And I'm like, I don't want this guy around my family. I know what goes on in my head. But I put that crap down on paper.
Yes.
I exercise those thoughts. I get them out.
Yeah.
What do you do with someone who's so much like you and doesn't release any of that?
Mm-hmm.
Where does it go? And shouldn't you really be afraid of those people?
All the places you're afraid it goes, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. And so, yeah, that the first act is me exercising that concept, which I think Gemma is doing as well.
Yeah. So, yeah, you know, the idea of monsters, the idea of people whose dark things are all on the outside, that's a real Nightbreed concept. It's very, very much what Clive Barker's playing with, in the same way that, yeah, exactly. In the same way that, you know, you look at the Cenobites and they seem so extreme at the time, and these days you're sort of like, oh, okay, so these are very S&M people. Well, at the time, you know, that was like...
They're Borg-like.
Him going, this is what I like. And people going, what? Fish hooks? Nails? What? You know, there's this real feeling that you should reject pain in popular culture. That pain is useless, that it's useless and it's dark and it scars you up. And you know, but I took my son to see Inside Out fairly recently and I was
great movie.
It was absolutely hilarious to me that a mainstream movie was essentially going, no, sadness is good. Pain is good. You need it. You need it to have an outlet to get these things where you can look at them and say, you know, that's not so bad. I can move on. I can move further. I can just keep going.
Yeah, we went to the drive-in and saw that movie. And Logan and my son and my wife, they're watching the movie and everything. And Danielle looks over at me and she's like, are you crying? I'm like, no.
Oh, I was crying from like 10 minutes in. Not even 10 minutes. I started crying during Lava, the short in front of it. You know, the two fucking volcanoes.
Oh yeah, yeah, they showed that. Right. Yeah.
Cal kept looking over me and going, "It's okay. It's all right."
There'll be a happy ending.
Wait a minute. What's wrong with crying during movies?
No, it's perfectly fine.
If you're a girl. Joe.
You want to see my dresses?
Yes.
Well, I cried, but they were manly tears, so
it's okay.
So were mine.
Let me get a few more audience questions out.
Okay.
I do have some aspiring writers that watch the show, and a couple of them want to know what would you suggest to aspiring. The word's novelist, but I assume any sort of fiction writer.
Okay. Just in terms of, like, general habits?
You know, they weren't specific, and there's, you know, how do you sell a story, or how do you write well? Those are two different questions.
Yeah,
so.
Those are two different questions.
Write well is the more interesting one.
Okay, so here's what I wish I'd known when I was younger. I wish I had known that things don't have to be perfect, and particularly in the first phase. My friend Douglas Clegg talks about the puke draft, where you just let everything go, you know, and then you look at it afterwards and you go, well, yeah, most of this is awful, but that and that and that and that and that are worth something. And then, you know, you pare it down and you pare it down and you realize what are the things that you actually should have been writing about from the very beginning. My methodology has consolidated into, I write about 10 words for every, 10 not useful words for every useful word. but the good thing about that is that afterwards I have no problem cutting stuff. I don't know whether it comes out of having a journalism background, but when somebody says you have to cut like 20,000 words out of this, I'm like, fine.
Yeah, wasn't it? I think it was Hemingway that said the first draft of anything is shit.
Yeah. Yeah. It's extraordinarily easy after the fact to see what should be kept and what should be thrown away. But I wish that I had known that you have to write the 10 not useful words to get the one useful word. And yeah, that you could allow yourself to do that and not censor yourself, because I spent a couple of years of my life, you know, more like 10 probably, you know, where my system was that I would write a page and then the next day I would go back and cut through that page and then write another page. Mm. So, you know, it's like write the whole thing, let it be what it is, then go back and fix it.
Yeah, and, if there's any one thing is like, that's the first thing they should tell everybody is like, you can't fix it till you have a draft.
Yes.
And a draft doesn't have to be good.
Yep.
All it has to be is you got from A to Z, and you're right. Yep. I don't know how many times I've spent an hour on a paragraph,
mm-hmm,
over and over and over, because in the old days, it would be, I'd have to get this paragraph right before I could move on to the next one.
Well, and that brings us to the secondary issue, which is the idea of the muse. I wish I had known that muses don't exist. I wish I had known that if you wait until something comes and perches on your shoulder and whispers shit in your ear, then you're never going to get anything done. I think it was Octavia Butler who said that habit is far more useful than inspiration in a lot of ways. So sit down and devote a certain amount of time to just following ideas. And the ones that are valid will bloom, and the ones that aren't valid, you know what? There's probably something interesting in there. So keep it. Yeah, that's the third part. Don't wait for your muse. But also don't throw stuff away either.
Right, the commonplace book as Lovecraft had.
Yeah, exactly. You know, when I was 15, I burnt everything that I had written up till then in a waste paper basket. And boy, I wish I had at least some of that stuff back. It was probably not that great, but I wish I had at least some of it back, because I'll bet you $5 there was something in there I could have used.
Very Lovecraft of you. I think he did the same thing.
Yeah. I think everybody's done the same thing.
I will not admit to have written that crap. I'm going to burn it.
Yeah.
Kind of feeling.
Who did this? It wasn't me. No, it was you. Own it, own it. But yes, absolutely. What Joe says is totally true. You cannot fix something unless you have it. Let yourself write it and then fix it.
Yeah.
Don't try to fix it and write it at the same time. So those are the three things that I wish I had known when I was younger.
Great advice. You were a film critic for quite a while.
Yep. Yeah, for about 8-9 years.
And you've talked about horror movies on the show so far. What about some of your favorite horror films?
Ooh. I have two huge folders full of DVDs and Blu-rays at home. And, you know, Some of them are comfort food. Some of them are films that I genuinely have only watched once and every once in a while I take them out and I look at them and I go, do I really want to see my tear again? Maybe not. But I want to own it. So that at some point I might have the possibility of seeing it again. I will tell you some of the films that I've seen most recently that have worked on me. Most recently, It Follows. Most recently, The Babadook. I was also really, really impressed by a couple of foreign horror movies that I saw in the last 5 years. One's called Sauna. It's from Finland. It's also known as Filth, which is like, it's like the Seventh Seal run through a J-horror filter. It's really amazing. And there's another one which comes from Brussels, which is, when you start out, I swear to God, you think it's an indie film about a young woman who's a runner, and she damages herself and will not be able to compete in the Olympics. And you're like, wow, this is just a nice little indie film. And then, no, turns out not. It just gets weirder and weirder and weirder until eventually, you know, you're trembling on the lip of a hole in the basement of an apartment building in Brussels, which is so old it goes back to the Middle Ages. Those are a couple of films that I've seen within the last 5 years that really worked on me. Spring. Spring is amazing. I don't know.
I have not seen it yet, but you know, for anybody watching, The Babadook and Spring and The Babadook and Spring are both available on Netflix streaming.
Yeah, and
I have not seen either one of those yet. They're kind of on my list. I saw It Follows on Laird's. Laird recommended it on Facebook.
Did you see Olivia Llewellyn's live tweeting of It Follows on Facebook? That was pretty amazing.
What was? I'm sorry.
Go back through her wall, and you'll find all these comments that she made.
Oh, Olivia! Yes, that was hilarious. She's like, "Oh my God, she's not really."
That's right. He's fucking the force of the void into him. It was just like incredible.
What was happening?
Yeah, that was it.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I think I saw Laird's post like. I don't know, when it was out in the theater, and I thought, I don't go to the theater too much, I'll wait till it comes out on Amazon Video or DVD or something.
Yeah.
And then, when it did, you know, I think Livia rented it from iTunes or something, and she's watching it, I'm like, okay, I gotta watch this, and I watched it the next day, so.
Yeah, but then again, I'll go through phases where I go back and I watch a bunch of movies that I've never seen before from a director that I like. A director who's, you know, one or two of things I've seen previously and I've liked them a lot. And sometimes that'll be somebody like Lucio Fulci, and wow, that's a lot of time spent watching giant splinters pushed into eyes and, you know, it's like spurting neck wounds and stuff like that. It's not that you get nothing out of it, but you do get to the end of that and you're like, wow, I don't know why I did that to myself. But then again, maybe you end up watching something like Cries and Whispers by Ingmar Bergman. I'm going through a lot of Bergman films these days. And those are really horrifying, emotionally horrifying. I don't know if you've seen Cries and Whispers, but wow.
Paul on the message board says, what was that movie that was, quote, Seventh Seal through a J-horror filter that you talked about?
That was Sauna. It's a Finnish movie. It's also known as Filth.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's see. Kimberly says, oh my God, I want to see Joe's dresses. And,
so do I.
Yeah, I think we all do. And I officially like Gemma Files. Marzia says, now I have to buy her novels. So, throwing a few comments out at you.
Cool.
So,
why don't we, in terms of celebrating film, why don't we move over to Len?
That's fine.
Amazing.
You showed my film to a film critic, Mike.
Yeah.
Put me on camera. No.
I really, really loved it.
Thank you.
Yeah. You know, when I contacted Len about being on the show, he's like, well, I don't know. I don't really know all that Lovecraft stuff really well. And I was like, that's okay. I don't either. I've got other guys on the panel for that. Pete and Rick know it pretty well. But, no, it's the, and Jim alluded to this a little while ago, it's those kind of subtle cosmic horror themes rather than, you know, just Cthulhu or Dagon have to be in this particular story. So.
Right, and you know, the idea of making this a Lovecraft story didn't initially come from me. The original script was actually written by my producer, Molo Alcocer, and it was this kind of sprawling story that took place over 15 years. And it was this kind of mysterious, shadowy figure that was plaguing this young girl in this family. And, you know, my primary problem with that script being that, you know, it was a short film that took place over such a long span that it became incredibly difficult to kind of connect to what was going on and connect to the characters and their struggle. And I wasn't particularly drawn to just this shadow that was kind of passing around and kind of torturing this family. And I showed it to my editor, Oliver Harwood, who is just kind of a lover of anything strange. You know, he grew up in Northampton, where what's his name's from? Graphic novelist.
Mike Mignola?
Alan Moore. Ah. So I'm a huge fan of Alan Moore and H.P. Lovecraft, and just he's always bringing me these just very strange things from the depths of, you know, his childhood, essentially. And he looked at this story and he was like, it kind of reminds me of something Lovecraftian. And that's what kind of brought me into, he gave me, you know, his copy of the Necronomicon, which is a collection of his short stories, not the Necronomicon from,
not the real one, because...
Not the real Necronomicon. I just started reading this stuff, and, you know, what I wasn't drawn to the monsters, per se, or the madness. It was more the philosophy of cosmicism. Because it came eerily close to my own fears about what was going on in the universe.
Yes.
And I was trying to tell this horror story that I think brought up a lot of things I was struggling with my own family in terms of facing these things that you felt like were just crushing you. And you had no way of fighting back and kind of understanding and, you know, looking at Lovecraft and cosmicism and cosmic horror. That became kind of the perfect avenue to explore those themes. And that's kind of, so I kind of ended up kind of backing into H.P. Lovecraft in terms of those cosmic horror themes. And it was the cosmic horror themes that really, where I found my connection to that kind of, you know, story in a way.
What, elaborate on those kind of, those real fears about the universe. That
right.
Well, and also Matt wants me to ask you about your background too. So.
Right. Well, I'm originally from New Jersey. Grew up in suburbia in New Jersey.
What exit?
Well, I was actually at the corner of Route 80 and 287.
I'm from Philadelphia, so.
Okay, so South Jersey, so North Jersey. So I had a fairly kind of idyllic suburban, you know, childhood. I was an avid reader, mostly of kind of fantasy-based stuff. It was always a very personal thing to me. It wasn't something that I shared. This was pre-internet, even though I'm relatively young. It wasn't about communities talking about these things. It was like you had these books and these movies that none of my friends were into, and it was a very personal thing where I'd hole up in my room and read this stuff and never wanted to talk to anybody about it, never wanted them to know I was into this stuff. And, you know, from there I went to college, a very liberal school up in Middlebury, Vermont. And, you know, I was raised Catholic, so that I had kind of cast aside, and I guess I was looking for a new philosophy, like how do I fit into the universe if there is no God? Mm-hmm. And I think in college I found kind of a benign sense of the universe. You know, I was happy. I believed that what was happening in my life was meant to be happening. I believed that the world was approaching... a more peaceful place. You know, this was before the Iraq War had kind of tumbled out of control, and, you know, I believe that the future would be brighter, and that my generation would be smarter, and that things were on this path. There was a benevolent force in the universe, whatever it might be. And then when these struggles started happening, you know, with my family, all of that came crumbling down, that sense of, you know, things happened for a reason, that they were being watched over, that just crashed. It all became random chaos, and just we're at the will of whatever will happen, and one day we will die, and nobody will care. And that sense of indifference of the universe and how small we were became very real. And that sense of meaninglessness in the face of that indifference. And so what Reaver is, in a sense, is an exploring of that philosophy. You know, you have this family, you know, this father who's caught up in this very Lovecraftian story. He's building this science fiction thing on the roof. He has had some kind of encounter. He appears to have lost his mind. You know, his kids don't necessarily believe him. He's caught up in a quintessential Lovecraftian narrative. But for me, to get that kind of catharsis in that sense that, you know, did not scare myself too much, you know, I created this brother and sister character who are seeing this potential horror approaching, and it becomes a story about them kind of clinging to each other, finding some sense of meaning through their connection to each other to kind of combat that philosophy. Whether they win or not is not the point. It's more of a kind of very small human victory of, well, yeah, this big, large Lovecraftian entity might kill us, take us away, reave us from, you know, the earth. But there's some small victory in just clinging to each other and telling it to fuck off, even if it's going to eliminate us.
And, you know, and definitely reconnecting with each other.
Right.
Over the realization that your father wasn't crazy.
Exactly. And, you know, so in a way it's this weird family drama about these kids realizing that their father was not his name, father also finding a connection to each other out of this kind of isolation that this force taking their father away had kind of this loneliness that it had kind of instilled in them, and this kind of focus on just themselves and their own problems, I guess. So it's this constant conflict between my fears that the universe is as indifferent and cruel as, you know, Lovecraft felt, but my character is very different from Lovecraft's characters. They don't slip into madness and, you know, curl up in a ball and just lose their minds and just their pen drifts off the page. You know, they turn to the darkened sky and flip the bird as, you know, you know, that kind of feeling, looking for some human victory and all of it. And I think that's kind of a quintessential difference in the kind of stories that I was raised on and kind of the world that Lovecraft saw himself in, I guess.
Well, if I can make you feel better about the whole universe being in
Please,
I think the universe doesn't.
Can you do that?
The house location. Did you go scout the house? Is that a house of someone you know?
It's a mystery story. The original location was. I don't know if anybody's
on the site. Matt, can you mute? Because I think echo on the moon.
Can you mute? Yeah, echo
on the moon. You got it? All right. I don't know if anybody saw Saving Mr. Banks, a movie about Disney and Mary Poppins.
Yeah.
You mean the
law. Yeah. Getting a lot of echo. So the farmhouse where her father died, that isolated house that up in the hills, that was the original location. For our film. I think because when Mr. Banks kind of moved in and had done a bunch of things and then another film had shot nearby, we ended up losing that location. So we were scrambling a week before shooting to find a new place to shoot. And this, the original story was supposed to be this very atmospheric, very, you had this like wide view of this environment, of the sky, of their loneliness and isolation in this place. It was supposed to be in the Colorado Hills. And when we lost that, it was an incredibly difficult location to find a backup for, you know, in Southern California within the shooting radius of Los Angeles. So we were scrambling a week before shooting to find a place that worked. And a friend of ours had shot in this house, a very different story, in this little house that happened to sit next to this dry riverbed on the edge of this neighborhood. So in a sense, we could still capture that sense of being on the edge of civilization in a way, and that sense of isolation. And we could get that shot of the storm kind of coming over the mountains. So it gave us that. And the difference being that the original house felt a little removed from time. And so what this other house gave us was a sense of a more kind of blue-collar, real feeling to their lives, which altered the story in certain atmospheric ways, but I think ultimately worked out great.
I think it was for the good because...
Yeah, me too.
Isolated... I think it's better than totally isolated because the feeling that I got from that house, whether it's that way in reality or not, was that it's in a neighborhood, but it's on the edge of the neighborhood.
Right.
And then the desert starts at their backyard.
Yeah.
you know, whether regardless of if that's the way the Real House is, that's the feeling I got from watching the short film. And yeah, it was perfect.
It's ultimately the reason we went with that location. There was something interesting about this house that wasn't all alone, but was right on the edge. And there were a few cut scenes where you see some of the neighborhood and the idea that this family is a little bit
pariahs.
Family at the end of the road, whose father went nuts and disappeared. Yeah. You know, there was in that flashback scene. There's a part with a neighbor who's, you know, clearly at odds with what the father's been doing on the roof. And there was this sense of them as this outcast family, which we ultimately cut for time. It didn't really serve the story. But so yeah,
sister mentions it briefly. I remember that.
Right. She says, you know, people are talking, or you know.
Yeah.
Part
yeah.
of people talking about us, and there was a little bit more of a sense of that. But
oh, you know, the other question, and I've already asked you this in an email a couple months ago, but I want to ask it in front of the audience. The TV documentary.
Right.
That the kid's watching, the older brother is watching that one night. It was perfect for the show. Could you talk about that a little bit? Because you said you were looking for something for quite a while.
What's in the movie now is this kind of vague, seemingly documentary series. This narrator is talking about fish, like comparing our lives to fish swimming in a pond. And it's a shot kind of looking up from the pond, and you see like a tree hanging overhead. And kind of comparing our lives to the lives of those fish, where there's this whole world in a dimension above them that they have no idea, and all they see is this kind of blurry shadow that kind of passes overhead. And the idea that that is the real universe as it exists, and it's a world that we just can't in any way understand. It's purely Lovecraftian, you know, the idea.
Yeah, I think it's a wonderful
in the grand scheme of things. Yeah. So, but what was originally on that TV, which had to be cut for licensing issues, is the flip side of the coin to the Lovecraftian philosophy in the film, which is, it was Carl Sagan. I was a huge fan of Cosmos, and, you know, I think I found a lot of comfort in sitting around and watching those old episodes of Cosmos, because when you hear Carl Sagan talk about the universe, it's not that it's a benevolent place, but everything is in its right place. It's as it should be. There's nothing, you shouldn't fear death, you shouldn't fear our small size. That is the way the universe should be, and it's beautiful in its completeness and in its, you know, being as it was meant to be, kind of thing. And it's Carl Sagan talking about, in the original clip, it's Carl Sagan talking about what would happen if a four-dimensional being, a being that lived in four spatial dimensions, as opposed to three, like we do, what would happen if a being like that were to descend into our plane? And furthermore, what would happen if it made contact?
Yeah, and how would you perceive them?
Yeah, and what if it actually plucked us into that fourth spatial dimension? The idea being that we would see a three-dimensional cross-section of a fourth-dimensional being. Now, I threw in, you know, the flip side of that coin is Lovecraft, because it was a horror film. What would happen if that being was not friendly? What if it didn't care about us or was cruel in some way? And that becomes the reaver of our film. The idea that this thing kind of dipped into our plane, has plucked their father out of the ether, and is kind of returning for them. And that becomes embodied as this crazy supernatural storm that rolls in over the hills. And you can imagine if that is a, you know, paper-thin kind of cross-section of a being, and it looks like a fast-moving cell storm, what the full being might actually be. You know, you're kind of Cthulhu, so to speak.
Have you read the novel Flatland?
No, I haven't actually. I've heard of it. I've never read it.
Yeah, very, very similar concept. So
right, and it's, you know, it's a concept in, I guess, theoretical physics, I guess, you know, or but the reason I was kind of drawn to that concept was it kind of gave us a little bit of an explanation for what a Cthulhu-type entity might look like in our world. It would not be a squid monster. It would be a cross-section of that squid monster. You wouldn't even be able to imagine, you know, the entity. You would see the underside of its foot, you know.
And toenail.
Right. Yeah, so well, kind of,
you couldn't use that Sagan clip, and so you replaced it with, I believe, something that you created, perfect.
Which leaned less towards describing the Reaver, the antagonist, and more towards getting at ideas of cosmicism and trying to plant that in the audience's head, as opposed to kind of an expositional thing.
The galaxy looks amazingly like a cell storm.
Right.
So there's that.
Right. and that's kind of the direction we went. It was a choice. You know, I don't know. It works for some people. It doesn't work for others. I think some people want that exposition. They want explanations. And 50% of the audience is like, don't explain it to me. I love just kind of living in that mystery. So, you know, you can't please everybody with that decision.
No, you can't. But those are the same. You know, the comments that I saw after I posted it, they were like 90% positive. Oh, this is awesome. And 10% were, well, that was kind of anticlimactic, wasn't it?
Right.
And I'm thinking, yeah, but if he'd created some kind of monster and showed it, then half the comments would be, well, that was a letdown, you know.
I'm in the 10%.
So
I'm in the 10% that feels like it's anticlimactic. I don't need to see the monster. What I need is a resolution of the story that's being told, which is the story of this brother and sister kind of reconnecting and coming to terms with the problem that was their father, I guess. And I don't see a full resolution to that story at the end of the film. Somebody posted on the film, which I think is a perfectly serviceable ending. It's like, why doesn't he have the keys? Like, if this story is about them, you know, saying, fuck it, let's just, you know, like, Thelma and Louise and just drive off into this thing. You know, why doesn't the garage come up and they just, you know, floor it into the mouth of Cthulhu kind of thing? And whether or not that's the perfect ending, it does give that kind of closure to that idea of the struggle.
Yeah.
If the father re-enters the story, that might help us resolve, you know, what's going on. I don't think that you need to see the monster. I don't think that's the resolution the audience is necessarily seeking.
Mm-hmm.
I think that if you can give them that other resolution of resolving the story I was actually trying to tell, which was not about a reveal of the monster, that might have created that closure that people wanted. So I was in that 10%.
You would have done it that way if you could go back and change it, or is that just another possible?
I think if I could go, I would change the ending. If I could go back, I think all filmmakers would change certain things about the film. This is one where I don't think I got the ending right because I couldn't see it. I don't think I quite knew what I had made because it was such a personal story. It was more of like, I feel this, and I'm just going to put it out there. And then once I made it, you know, and I saw it, I was like, oh, well, I could have brought resolution, I think, to it instead of leaving it so open. Because I wasn't resolved about it at the time that I made it. You know, I'm a year and a half, 2 years removed. I'm 2 years older. I think I found more of a resolution to that story than I had, you know, at the time that I made it. So it was open-ended because I was open-ended. At the time, I was lost and confused in that conflict, and now I've kind of made peace with it. So I'm like, yeah, they would just like jam the keys in and ride off into the storm, kind of. You know, that's me now. You know.
Are you working on a full length?
That's the question I get the most. Is, you know, where's the feature version of
the story? Not necessarily a feature version of that, but
right.
A feature.
I've been working on a number of things. You know, I think I false started on a number of stories immediately following that. Because when people saw that, they're like, oh, here's, you know, a new horror director.
Mm-hmm.
And I never really saw myself as that. You know, what I saw going on in horror right now, I don't have a very strong connection to. It's a lot of ghosts.
Right.
I do really like The Babadook, and it follows conceptually as, you know, one of the most unique horror films in recent memory.
Mm-hmm.
But going in, you know, I got meetings based off this film, and it was all like, okay, so what's your million-dollar horror film idea? You know, that's going to do what Blumhouse is doing, and that, and I didn't have that. So what that has created is I have begun to develop, you know, maybe 60 pages in on a script that is a spiritual successor to Reaver. I kind of came obsessed with what happens after they drive off.
Hmm.
And what if the monster was kind of more physical. So I've been working on the story about a brother-sister who've been on the road for 5 years with this kind of Lovecraftian entity just constantly. And this was before I saw It Follows, which is probably why I moved on a little bit. But they just had this kind of relentlessly pursuing antagonist. And they were living on the road, and they could not settle down, and they had no sense of family or home because they were constantly having to be on the move. And then It Follows came out, obviously, which has that a little bit, and it, you know. So I stepped away a little bit to try to figure out how I can make it a little bit more different. On top of that, I've been writing all these short stories. They're all monster movies. Every single one is a character with a conflict in their life, or a family conflict, or a relationship conflict, or just, you know, me versus society, or me versus myself kind of conflict, and that becomes embodied in a kind of classic monster tale, where they get to kind of confront that problem directly. without really seeing that the monster is a perfect reflection of that kind of problem. So I've been developing that as kind of an anthology, toying with the idea of doing an anthology film, all by one director, not kind of a multi-director anthology, and developing that Reaver kind of spiritual successor as a possibility. And while randomly getting random ideas out of my head that are completely out of left field. Just sometimes a story just hits me, and I'll write part of it and just like throw it away and go back to what I was doing. That sort of thing. But certainly people expected me, you know, after I made this film, just to go do a horror feature.
Yeah.
And I was like, I don't really like, there's a certain kind of horror film that I like. It's not ghost stories, you know. I'm very particular about the kind of horror film that I like, and it's, you know, hard to go into those rooms and pitch something that I think is a little outside the box.
Well, you mentioned It Follows and The Babadook. What are some other horror films that you really like?
Since you're... Like recently or just kind of over history?
Either or both.
Right. Those were definitely the two last year that I thought had done something. You know, I thought The Babadook had beaten Blumhouse firmly at its own game, and It Follows, just conceptually, it was like, that concept is so easy, or so simple and beautiful. Like, how has nobody ever made that, you know, as a film? Because it's also very easy to shoot in a lot of ways. You know, I was raised on horror films from a very young age. They were a very particular kind of horror film, made by very, very good directors who were masters of their craft at the top of their game. You know, I wasn't brought up on kind of like grindhouse or kind of B-movie horror. You know, I was a child of the like late 80s and 90s, so I was all kind of Jaws and John Carpenter and The Fly and The Omen and The Exorcist. These were all movies that, you know, people say they don't watch horror films. Some of the best movies ever made are horror films. You know, The Shining, you know, if you say you don't watch horror, you're missing out on some of the best straight up films, you know, that have ever been made. It's like saying I don't watch crime movies, or, you know, I don't watch love stories. You know, it's like, okay, so you just cut out all of those films that, you know, just because you don't like the idea of horror.
Right.
So
that have elements.
Growing up, horror was an A genre to me. It was not the double feature monster movie. It was not the B genre. It was made by the best directors. They were made by Polanski, Spielberg, you know, De Palma. You know, they were made by, you know, Carpenter. People might disagree with me, but I'm a huge fan of, you know, Carpenter.
No. It's funny because you put De Palma in there, and I agree with you. I think he's a great director. But at the time,
right?
Yeah,
he wasn't.
But what I'm saying is, by the time I had seen it, right?
So you just called us old.
What'd you say?
He's called us old.
Well, I mean, I call myself a little bit younger. I'm not gonna put any numbers out there. But in a way, yes. I
think it is true that film history has resized those films a bit.
Right.
And the same thing with Carpenter. And
that's when I encountered them.
Right.
Yeah. So when I encountered these movies, they were made by the best guys around. And that was my introduction to horror. It was not as it was coming out in theaters. I would have been, you know, too young to see it. And I was seeing them at a very young age. I was seeing them at 8 years old, 9 years old, on VHS. You know, I was seeing Alien and The Shining and Predator and, you know, The Thing. You know, I was seeing these movies at, you know, 8 to 10 years old on VHS. And that was kind of my introduction. I was always a bit turned off by the slasher and the... kind of like, I could not handle Hellraiser. When you said Hellraiser, I was just like, ugh. Like, that movie really creeped me out. It was so dark, it's so brutal.
It is.
You know, that was not my cup of tea. Also, I was too young. You know, when I was encountering horror, it had to have heroes. It had to have a sense that, you know, we might win, maybe, some small victory, you know?
And whereas one of the most formative things for me when I was younger was Angel Heart, actually.
Oh, nice, nice.
Yeah, which is not a we win kind of scenario.
No.
Like,
you know, a true story. I guess it was in the early 80s. We went and bought our first VCR.
Mm-hmm.
We got our first video club membership, and for the first time, after a couple months, my parents let us pick our own movies. My sister, who's like 10 years old,
yeah.
I Spit on Your Grave.
Oh, oh my God.
This is the original.
Yes.
Oh my God. Wow. And he laughed the whole damn thing.
The difference being, you know, when I was that same age, what horror was going into a theater at 9 years old and watching Jurassic Park. You're watching, it's now in the realm of popcorn blockbuster.
Right.
It's a horror film, and I'm 9 years old in a PG-13 movie. Yeah.
I got to see Alien in the theater with my mother's hand like this.
Right.
Okay.
So it was that experience kind of over and over, and that was kind of the horror that I watched. I knew about Friday the 13th and its million iterations. The only one that I really liked was Nightmare on Elm Street, because it's just this kind of great psychological thriller and bizarre fantasy story on top of the slasher.
Yes.
So the original, at least, is just so bizarre in so many ways, and just the feeling of just, like, you can't sleep, like, you need to sleep to live, like, these characters are so fucked, you know, they're just wildly creative. I was 10 years old when Scream came out and kind of took a new look at the horror genre. So, you know, Wes Craven, John Carpenter, and this, you know, Cronenberg, like, these were kind of the guys that I was raised by. Yeah. And a lot of that came from my mother for some reason. She, you know, when she would say, you have to watch this movie, it was like, you know, they were Catholic, so it was like, you got to see The Shining, you know, The Exorcist, you have to see The Omen, you know. They loved The Shining, so I saw that at an age that was like, I could not understand what these movies were really getting at. But,
so, I guess,
you know.
2 weeks ago, my son just turned 16, and 2 weeks ago we sat him down, we went and let him watch Reanimator for the first time.
Is that a horror film? I always viewed it as a comedy.
Afterwards, he turns to me and says, so, Dad, let me get this straight. You based your entire literary career off of this crappy B-movie.
With the whole joke of the dick getting head. Yes, absolutely.
Yes, sure. Okay, yeah.
Well, you know, you were talking about watching movies as a kid. Joel and I were both born in 1955, so we were used to seeing the old Universal and later Hammer movies.
Right.
And in that one, the monster always got destroyed.
Right.
Right.
And when I was watching them as a kid, I was going, I'd like to see the monster win once in a while.
Well, you know,
and then the pendulum swung totally a different way.
Right.
You argue that the Hammer Frankenstein movies are about the monster winning all the time because Baron Frankenstein is the monster.
Yes.
Well, he survives. There are some where he's supposed to get killed. And also, the continuity of that series kind of got confused after the first two movies.
It was one of the reasons I loved Carpenter. I mean, The Mist. The ending of The Mist is one of the most brutal endings to a movie ever. Because it has that emotional catharsis. You think about emotional family story.
That's why The Mist is now on Netflix streaming, and I the other day I thought, I should watch that. I'm like, no, I can't watch that ending again, not as a
Right, I know, it's brutal. And, you know, The Thing has that great, ambiguous, you know, ending. But they are about these people, they're fighting back.
Yeah.
You know, they aren't up against ghosts, you know, throwing away Ghostbusters. You know, in a lot of kind of modern horror, it's always a monster that you cannot contend with.
And I agree. I agree that there's something very puritanical about that, the idea that there is no way out. And it doesn't even help if you acknowledge your own guilt. It doesn't even help if you try to make reparation. It doesn't help. Nothing helps.
No.
God, speaking of that, Gemma, did you read Stephen King's recent book, Revival?
Yes.
I don't want to spoil it for anyone who hasn't read it, but that's exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah. Yeah,
you that's are what crappy
as hell, and it is so dark. It is. It leaves you in such a bad place.
It does.
It's fascinating.
You know, we were talking earlier about Ben's open-ended ending, and you know, some of the best Lovecraftian films leave the endings open. The Corridor.
I've never actually seen The Corridor. I really want to, but it's hard to get a hold of unless you have Netflix. And
right.
I mean, that weird sort of between formats.
Yeah. And then just the first time I watched it, I this Yellow Brick Road.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Well, Yellow Brick Road is like a Jeff Vandermeer story brought to life.
Yeah, you watch that and you say, what the fuck did I just watch?
Mm.
And then you watch
it again. That's exactly what I said.
I kept saying, wait, what?
You know? And
but there are moments in that which have a purity and a kind of amazing terror to them.
Yeah, well, I think this the scene with the field glasses.
Yeah.
Is completely silent.
Yeah.
From one point of view. It's just terrifying.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But also when the guy's behind the break and the girl is talking to him and she's like, you don't have to come over and kill me. And he's like, no, I do. I really do. And it's going to hurt. It's going to hurt a lot.
I just got to do it.
It's the best, she said, laughing. those are the moments that I live for in horror culture.
These are not movies that Joe particularly likes because they're violent and
right.
But they are, you know, if you even if you stripped out the violence from, say, Yellow Brick Road, you still got this immense story about people who make the worst decisions ever.
And every decision is worse than the last because there's no good decisions to be made after a certain point.
Right.
You know, it's like your real mistake was that you made that first decision, but you don't know that until like 5 days from now,
or 50 years, or
down that road.
Right. Yeah. The mistake was getting up in the morning.
Time is holding, and you're hearing other time periods, and this horrifying.
Len, have you guys seen Absentia?
Yes.
That's the next one I was going to talk about.
Well, yeah, go ahead, Pete.
Well, Absentia has a little bit of closure because you do get to see the monster, you do get to see what's happening, but only a little bit.
Absentia is like a Caitlin Kernan short story brought to life.
Yes.
Because there's this thing going on, and you see a part of it, and you will never see the whole of it.
Yeah, and I talked to the director of that movie a couple of years ago, and he said a lot of that had to do with budget, and he was really glad that it worked out that way because he felt it made a better film.
Yes, yeah, I agree. Micro-budget is really, really good for that. You have to make these strategic decisions.
This is a problem I'm confronting with the story I'm working on now, where it's like, I know this has to be cheap. I know that I'm designing, trying to design a monster that I've never seen before.
Yeah.
And how do you do that in a way that is scary and that is unique and is kind of original and serves the low budget nature of what you're trying to do, meaning that the budget constraints don't limit the power of what you're doing.
Yes.
If you get a chance, watch the commentary for the Chiodo Brothers' Killer Clowns from Outer Space.
I love that. I talk about that movie with a friend of mine every week.
watch the commentary, because what he tells you is that we had a prop guy and we decided that we didn't need a prop guy because the prop guy said, you need a popcorn gun. I need $5,000. And the other guy said, you need a popcorn gun. How long is it on screen? And I said, 10 seconds. And I said, I can make you one for $50.
Right.
So you go with the $50 guy.
And you go with the $50 guy. And it fires once and it's done.
Mm-hmm.
But that's how you get through your movie.
Yeah.
Well, Len, you were just talking about how do you show a monster on a limited budget that's not cheesy and all that so forth. I'm not a filmmaker, will never be a filmmaker. Just my thought as a viewer and as a writer is one answer showing just part of it.
Yes.
Just showing what it's representing,
Well, always there's that question of what comes into the frame and what's outside of the frame.
Yes.
And I really think that, showing a part of the monster, showing someone's reaction to something is often 10,000 times more horrifying than showing the thing itself. There's that thing that King says in Dance Macabre when he's talking about the haunting, the original haunting, that you don't want to see what's on the other side of that door. You see the door bulging, you see the two of them horrified by what's going on outside. You don't want to see what's outside the door. You could whip it open and it might be a bug that was 90 feet tall and everyone would go, ah! And then they go, oh, thank God, I thought maybe it would be 100 feet tall.
You're right.
You're also dealing with audience expectation. It Follows, I said, I liked. I thought it was, at least conceptually, one of the most interesting horror films made in years.
Yes.
I do not give that movie a free pass, because I view the second half as not scary and silly, and you know, it just doesn't, it has nowhere left to go. From the moment they fully reveal,
I don't know
what this monster does to that guy's mom, to the son.
I understand.
It's a total letdown. And how do you give the audience what they need out of that monster?
What I liked about it going into the second half, and I understand, you know, right, what you're saying, but what I liked about it going into the second half was the first half was all about, is that thing in the background the monster?
Right. And that's when it's at its peak. That's when it's at its best.
And then you get the moment when she's with all her friends at the cabin, where right, you see the friend behind and the friend over there.
Which I did not understand when I saw the movie.
Yeah, and you realize it can look like your friend. Right. Oh, remember that part? Yes, actually, I do remember that part now.
Until the movie's over. Like,
and then from there, you move on to what is the thing that is going to make itself look like that will be most emotionally horrifying to you, which leads to it being her father.
Right, which I also didn't know until after that scene was over.
Yeah, leads to it, the naked man on top of your roof being your grandfather, and the guy who's here to kill you being and fuck you to death being your father. Right.
None of which did I get when I saw the film.
Mm. Well, now it's completely right.
I saw it. Yeah. So I don't know whether like, that's 50.
Some people get it, some people...
Yeah, no, totally.
You know?
Yeah.
But for me, it was like, how do you give them that moment? You've established this monster. The concept is brilliant. Yeah. I mean, for it follows. It's just great. It's scary. The question is, once things hit a critical mass and the audience needs a release, whether that release is scare the shit out of me now, or, you know, a kind of climax to the film, you know, how do you give them what they need in a way that's not tired at this point? And I think It Follows falls in the trap of trying to do that normal movie climax, which is the pool scene, which is horrible.
Yeah.
For so many reasons.
Okay.
Well, it just doesn't get there, you know.
It's a terrible, terrible plan, but which was made up by teenagers who haven't slept for quite a while.
Okay. I mean, okay, you know, maybe, you know.
No, you know, it's like, I got it on Blu-ray fairly recently, and my husband kept watching it over and over and over again over one weekend.
Right.
And so I became fairly conversant with it very quickly.
I buy it in in Nightmare on Elm Street. I get it. They're sleep-deprived. It's hard for them to function. I buy that. I have a major problem with stupid characters in the horror
films. Totally.
Don't care. I prefer the characters to be smart, and they're doing the right thing all the time, but the problem is the monster's just that powerful, or smart, or the situation's just that bad.
That's a good point.
But also,
it falls in that trap of, in order to keep the monster scary, the characters have to be dumb.
I agree. I completely understand.
And that's been my struggle with what I'm working on, because my characters are smart. And so how do I really make this thing, what does this thing have to be capable of that... It doesn't matter how smart they are. Yeah. You know, this thing is going to be stronger than them. They're not going to understand what it is, what it wants, what it's doing. But, you know, it's going to catch up to them. It's going to, you know. So that's, I've been caught in this trap of, like, having to look at It Follows, because what I was writing, It Follows came out as I was writing this thing, and trying to make, how do I make the monster unassailable? Like, how do I not have to dumb my characters down in order to keep the monster scary?
Okay, so
they're not trapped in a place, you know.
There are two things that come into my mind, and the first one is that with It Follows, the thing that they never thought to do was to go back down the line.
Yeah.
Potentially possible.
And I'm like, you idiots,
where the hell this started? Because if you can find out where it started, you might be able to nip it off there.
Right.
Secondarily, is it possible to immobilize the thing so that it can't move?
Right.
It's slow. It's not stupid, but it is slow. My husband said, sorry, that's my phone. It's slow, but it's not stupid. You could potentially dig a pit, have it fall in the pit, and then cover it with quick drying cement.
But these aren't things I want to be thinking while I'm watching a horror film, you know?
No, absolutely, but, you know. I remember describing it to my mother, and she was like, well, what if you got on a plane and you went to another country?
Yeah,
and
I said, don't, it has an aversion to water.
Walking out of the sea very slowly towards you.
I have a very love hate relationship with that film. I think the concept is brilliant. Do I think it was fully utilized to its potential? Not even close.
Absolutely. Yeah,
I think following it back to its root.
There is a philosophical problem, which is that essentially the monster is death. And you get to the end of that film and you're like, well, you can't beat death, can you, really? You know, it's like, yeah, I'm going to put you in a place where you will never die. Everything will work out. There's nothing following you slowly, waiting to kill you. That's not reality. And everyone knows it. Everyone in the audience knows it.
You mentioned following it back to the root. I think that would have made a better second half as well, just in terms of story.
When they went to the house, it seemed like that's what Mike
would have done.
Right.
Yeah,
so
that's what
I like the characters and their general stupidity, and that kind of detached me from caring whether or not the thing raped them into the void or whatever it does.
Well, I watched it with my wife, and I'm like, no, they're being idiots. Why aren't they doing this? And she's like, okay, you're almost half a century old. They're 20-year-old children. I mean, take that into account.
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah, okay, but still.
I don't even think they're 20-year-olds.
Yeah, maybe not even that old.
No, it hasn't hurt the film's popularity or how many people saw it and enjoyed it. But
I still did enjoy it, but I do take your point. Yeah.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be able to get past those problems as a writer in terms of allowing those problems to exist. You know.
Totally agree.
And that was a problem I ran into. So I was writing the story that was similar in a lot of ways in terms of a relentless pursuit. When I hit those problems, I'm like, God, how the hell do I solve that? And then I saw it falls. I'm like, they didn't even try. And they just made $30 million. So, you know, maybe I should just not worry about it.
And they tried to really spell out that death thing. That, you know.
So
the worst thing that it is certain, that quote from the idiot. So.
Yes. Yes. In 5 minutes, in 2 minutes, in 1 minute, in less than a minute, you will cease to exist.
And the worst thing is that it is certain. Yeah.
Right.
Yes.
But I would call it a straight. I think it's a Lovecraftian narrative. There's no explanation or rhyme or reason to why this thing should exist or where it came from. There's, you feel characters are completely powerless. You know, in every sense.
Yeah. Yeah.
And slowly losing their minds over the course of this story. You know, in the face of this. God knows what it is, kind of coming up. So it's probably the most Lovecraftian film I've seen in a long time that's successful at it. You know,
I mean, I look at it from a witchcraft point of view, and it's obviously a curse.
Right,
I
a think gypsy probably, curse.
No, right. Not a gypsy curse.
No, I know, I'm just kidding.
It seems like a curse that probably stems from someone being sexually betrayed. I think that person you saw in the first instance, the chick whose teeth have been punched out of her face, pissing on herself, it's entirely possible that might be the person who laid that curse.
Yeah.
And I think that she killed herself, so she can't take it off.
I lean more towards what Gemma is saying, and I like Lovecraftian stuff, obviously, but it doesn't seem like cosmic horror to me. It's more of a curse. You know?
It's more grounded. It's grounded in kind of a social thing. I mean, there's this thing about sex and like a clear kind of thing about sexual violence and that kind of thing. So that obviously makes it very base and human.
Well, and I've thought about it because I've got this nice grand list at the Lovecraft eZine website where I try to list some very good movies with Lovecraftian themes, not just old hats like The Dunwich Horror or, you know, junk like that. And I'm like, should I put the following on this list? And ultimately, I feel that no, I shouldn't. But that's just my opinion.
Okay. I think that, you know, I know you like Libby Llewellyn's work, and I think it is Lovecraftian in the same way that Libby's work is Lovecraftian.
Yeah. That's
and true. That's why that whole, you know, comment tree on Facebook amused me so much, because it is like, yeah, I get why Laird likes this, I get why Libby likes this. It's very much a jam.
I think It Follows, a movie like It Follows would feel more Lovecraftian if there was any attempt to confront not confront physically, but intellectually, or, you know, in any attempt to understand what they were up against.
Yeah.
Why does something like this exist? Where does it come from?
Yes.
There's no attempt to do that at all. It's just a mad scramble to stay alive, right? Yeah. If they had confronted the ideas that were there, it would feel a lot more Lovecraftian to it.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting because over the last 10 years, the core audience for horror films has gotten younger and younger. And the core cast for horror films has gotten younger and younger. And I think that there's this sense that people who are that young can't be intellectuals, which is bullshit, obviously. You know, I was a teenage geek, you were a teenage geek, we were all teenage geeks, right? You know, my reaction to that would not necessarily be to screw three guys in a boat. My reaction to that would be to try and find out where that came from and try and find out what you can do.
Right.
And it would be really interesting, too. It would be
interesting. Yeah, I think it's more a more interesting narrative, but it's a more difficult narrative.
Yeah, it's a much more difficult narrative, which is why people don't... Right. I think people feel that the amount of time that you have in a film, which is true, you know, it's a very short window, right. Even when you're talking about 2 hours. 2 hours versus 10 hours, right? Mm. 2 hours versus 8 hours. You know, what you can do with True Detective and what you can do with Heat.
Right.
You know, Gemma, sorry.
It's okay.
I think a good example of that is the Japanese version of The Ring versus the American version.
Yeah.
They end up in the same place.
Right.
But the final decisions of the main characters are very, very different.
Well, that's because the two films are very different culturally.
Right.
Right.
It's actually one of the most interesting adaptations I've seen of a movie from another culture being brought to America.
Right.
Because by reframing it with Lovecraftian tenets rather than the original very Japanese animistic kind of tenets. You know,
because we have no basis for that in our culture.
Exactly. The difference between, you know, Frolic and Brian, Goblins Be Thine, and, well, we went to a guy to get a child, and they gave us a child from somewhere, and we don't care, and we don't know.
It kind of delves more into kind of, like, gothic kind of roots of horror in America, as opposed to...
Right.
Going from, you know, going from... the Izakaya Peninsula to Maine, right?
Right.
And suddenly it becomes far more Stephen King-like and far more Lovecraftian, far more Lovecraft-like.
Right, right.
You know,
it's a whole bunch of a ghost story.
Yeah.
But also there's a kind of fatalism in Japan that is not American.
Right.
So no American is going to go, well, I guess that you... just lie down and die, you know, just
We came out on the other side of World War II, and that kind of, I think, colored, you know, our view of ourselves and our society a little bit.
Yeah, so, you know, this sense of individuality, this sense of, you know, it's like, no, man, I'm going to fist fight this chick when she comes out of the TV.
Yeah, we were talking about isolation earlier, and I'm going to probably butcher this, but there's a concept of Hattori in Japan. It's the idea that you can be isolated somewhere far away.
Yeah.
You can be completely alone in the middle of a city.
Yes. Right. Yeah. You know what's really good for that is Kiyoshi Kurosawa's Pulse.
Kaido. Yes.
The movie that was horribly, horribly fucked up and adapted as Pulse.
Yeah.
Because it's such a Japanese concept and people just did not get it.
Yeah.
And yet, when you think about it, that's like the... that's the most integral part of internet culture, is the idea that, you know, you think that you're attached to all these people that you've never seen. You know, you're actually alone in a room. You're living and dying alone in a tiny room, but you think that you know all these people that might as well be ghosts for all you know.
Right, right.
Yeah. If you ever get the chance to see Kairo, so good, so amazing. And it's so much about loneliness. And it's so much about that concept of Hattori.
No, you've really intrigued me with that. And I realized when Pete brought up The Ring that I've never seen the Japanese version. So I have to
you've never seen The Ring. That
well, I have the Japanese and the Koreans.
Yeah.
I'll send them all to you.
Oh. Did I tell you what a good friend you are?
Yeah. And whatever you do, there's a Netflix something called Sadako. On Netflix, which is a sequel that has nothing to do with it. It's horrifically bad. Don't watch it.
Okay.
No. Yeah. Probably no danger in that. So, the last thing I want to say about It Follows being Lovecraftian or not, I think it has elements of some Lovecraft stuff. Would be the Lovecraftian themes would be the way I describe it. Just like Pete and I talked a while back about the skeleton and whether I should
Ropa report. Yeah.
Yeah, I think Europa Report is I would classify it as a Lovecraftian film. Although it's a pretty gray line, but yeah. Skeleton yeah. Key, no, it's got some Lovecraftian elements in it, but it doesn't have any cosmic horror
right.
elements.
Skeleton Key has stole a critical concept from Lovecraft, but there's no Lovecraftian elements in it.
What, the idea of body swapping? I mean, yeah. that's been around forever.
Yeah, but you know, the way it's done was
Let's face it. When I use the word Lovecraftian, what I really mean personally is cosmic horror.
Yes.
You know?
That
to me, like, quintessentially, like cosmic horror film is a film like Event Horizon.
Yeah. Right.
You know exactly.
It's, yeah. You're not completely wrong, and you're not completely right.
Well, of course, no matter what I do on this list, every time I post it on the Facebook page, 80% of the people are like, "Oh, great list." The other 20% are like, "This idiot doesn't know anything about what makes a film Lovecraftian." So,
in the sense, you're gonna remove kind of the
judgment call.
Yeah, the Quatermass experiment.
The sprawling mythology of Lovecraft. You know, most films won't try to do anything that even tries to approach that. I mean, you have Del Toro doing Mountains of Madness right now, which has kind of ties in a little bit to that.
I don't think you need it. Del Toro's not doing Mountains of Madness. That was canceled.
Yeah.
Oh, did it get canceled?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, unfortunately.
Yeah, Crimson Peak. Basically, he was like working on it for 3 years, and finally they were like, "Nope, it's not going to happen," which is such a pisser because...
I'm so busy this summer, I didn't even hear the news. All right, well, anyway. Very few stories try to confront that kind of deep mythology of kind of ancient forces, ancient alien races, and all that I think is obviously associated with Lovecraft. But there's kind of a lesser Lovecraftian kind of thing going on, which is like early stuff that's closer to Poe, and like, you know, one of my favorite stories is like a Statement of Randall Carter, which is somewhat of just like a little gothic horror story. It's actually my favorite, even though I don't think it's his best. Yeah, and it's really like, I went out with this guy, and he wanted to do something in a cemetery, and he gave me one end of the telephone, and I went down into the... He went down into this crypt, and then after a few minutes, while I was just sitting in the cemetery and getting creeped out...
Surprise, something bad happened.
Shut the door, get out of here, run away! And I'm frozen in place because all of his characters, like, are, you know, about to faint at any given moment. And, you know, it's just simple, and, you know, the simple gothic horror story, and you're just like, what the hell is under the ground? What does this guy see? Why won't he tell me what he sees? You know? And that's so different from the Cthulhu mythologies and the, you know, so when you say Lovecraftian, you have to be, I think, a little bit more specific about what kind of different Lovecrafts. As his life progressed, he started to change, and, you know.
Have any of you guys ever read a book by Jeff Long called The Descent?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Sounds familiar, but I don't think I've read that. Someone else has talked about it recently.
It was bought and turned into a bad movie.
No, it wasn't.
Yeah. Well, okay. It was bought and turned into a movie that had no relation to the book whatsoever.
Wait, so is the movie The Descent based on the book?
Seriously, Dave was actually based on The Descent?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Yes. From what I've read, they paid him for that and then just
Holy
did something
Joe. I had no idea that was actually true. Because I remember at the time going, is this going to be The Descent? And then I went to see The Cave and it was like, no. No, The Descent is literally about discovering that in the inner earth, very, very, very far deep, almost as deep as the Marineris Trench, there is a interior section of the earth which is like hell. There are people who live down there who are like demons. This is where all those legends come from.
Mm-hmm.
But usually what happens when you adapt the set. They drop the mythology, they drop the sense of time and place, and they just keep the monster.
Yeah.
You know, which is the same thing that happened with Reanimator, actually.
Yeah.
Completely drop any sense of the time and place, which is so integral to the story.
The 20s, yeah.
You know, and it just becomes about a wacky guy reanimating corpses.
Yeah.
Well,
you know what, Len, if you ever get it into your mind to film Mountains of Madness, I'm sure we can do a Kickstarter that'll fund you.
Just beat Guillermo del Toro to it. I mean, what do you need? He's just, you know, guys traipsing through. Oh, man.
The Arctic.
I'll tell you what you need. You need a great director, and you need a lot of money.
Right.
You know, and that's why all these Lovecraftian short films nobody's really they tackle other Lovecraft stories, but they don't really tackle At the Mountains of Madness, not live action. You know, they do Pickman's model and things like that, because that's an expensive movie to make.
Right. Yeah.
You know? Well, I don't know. I mean, the HPL Society did a pretty amazing version of Call of Cthulhu.
That they did.
Silent film.
Yeah, they did.
That was about as big as I've seen something like that get.
And you know, John Carpenter's Prince of Darkness and In the Mouths of Madness.
In the Mouth of Madness more than Prince of Darkness, but yeah.
Yeah.
Prince of Darkness I see as being more like a riff on all sorts of giallo directors. It's like an American giallo.
And I thought Dagon did Shadow out of Over Innsmouth really well.
Yeah.
My personal opinion.
Yeah, so I've taken shit from some of my friends for liking Dagon, but I do like Dagon.
I think it's great.
Yeah.
And you know, it really gives the atmosphere of the place right. You know, this rain, this claustrophobic town. On the ocean, on this port, you know, it's just, it's great.
Again, the interesting production decision to shoot it in Spain, which they did because that's where you could get the money, totally works out, because simply by shifting Innsmouth to Imboca,
right.
you bring in that sense of otherness, you know. I'm sure Spanish people watch that and they're like, what? But it really brings across that sense of being in a place where you don't understand anybody, literally and figuratively. Are these people even human? That's the centrality of Lovecraft.
That's the one thing I do like about Dagon, is that the first people we meet in the town pretty much look like they could pass for normal.
Mm-hmm.
Which is what you're supposed... Yes, they might have some bug eyes or but they're not fish people yet.
Mm-hmm.
The operative word there being yet. You see a lot of these production, you know, artwork and designs, and I see, this week's Innsmouth resident, and they're all full-form fish people. They would never pass for human whatsoever. I think...
Even somebody like Usha, the girl, you know.
Yeah. Just
that Macarena Gomez with her amazing hyperthyroid eyes and her weird... You know, her weird cheekbones.
Yeah.
Her strange thinness. She's got that very particular kind of charisma, which comes out of being really neurotic and foreign. That, you know, at the minute the tentacles come out from underneath the rug, you know, you're sort of like, well, on the one hand, but on the other hand,
And you're right, H.P. Lovecraft Historical Society did great with Call of Cthulhu, they did really great with Whisper and Darkness, but those are, I would imagine, compared to the kind of budget that you would need to do At the Mountains of Madness right, aren't anywhere in that ballpark.
No,
and I emphasize to do it right.
You know.
And the mountains at the Mountains of Madness, it has to be done. There's got, if it's filmed right, it's got to be. There's got to be some subtlety to it.
Yeah.
That you really have to have the right director and the right vision, you know, or otherwise it's just going to end up being.
The production design is going to make or break that.
Right.
Yeah.
Probably the most difficult thing is going to be, how do you summarize all that cosmic history?
Right. That's the primary difficulty with things that approach the larger mythologies.
Yeah, and further, being in Antarctica, there's no local guy who's been studying this for the last 10 years who can just, you know, onto the screen. And
I'm sure once they're done with it, there will be.
Well, yeah,
that character would pop up somehow.
Or if you did say... Yeah, if you did set At the Mountains of Madness in, and there's reasons for and against in the modern world, you know, finding somebody on the internet who's an expert in this too, you know, that you're video chatting with. I don't know. I'm just throwing things out there.
The Last Winter has flashings of that.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, that's a great movie.
Yeah.
What was that?
The Last Winter.
Oh, thanks.
Larry Fessenden.
What about, was it Blood Glacier?
I haven't seen Blood Glacier. Yeah. I believe it's a Swiss movie. Sort of a cross between The Thing and a bit of a Mountains of Madness idea.
Right. Well, let's talk about, let's wrap up soon and give away prizes, and let's talk about what's coming out now and or has just come out. Lois Gresh edited Ends With Nightmares, which I think is coming out next month. Do I have that right, guys?
No, it's already out.
Is it already out? Cause,
yeah, people have it.
All kinds of people are reading it.
Okay. I'm going to have to get a copy somehow.
Contributors haven't seen copies yet. I might like to add. Even though we're, like, next door, but, you know.
I'm sure Lois is watching right now, and now you've let her know.
Well, it's not her fault. She's not shipping them. Yeah.
Sounds like it's a great book. As I say, I haven't read it yet, but okay, so we got Gemma's book coming out in November. Mm-hmm. Experimental film. At Necronomicon, I'm gonna have copies of Scott Thomas's The Sea of Ash and Joe's King and Yellow Tales.
Cool.
And Pete and I will have copies of Pete, explain this little book real quick.
The Lurking Chronology. It is a... So, God, 20 years ago maybe? Peter Cannon did a chronology of all of H.P. Lovecraft's Cthulhu Mythos stories. It's a ghastly expensive little book now because it's never been reprinted. But it's a go-to guide for figuring out when things happened in Lovecraft. In the course of doing all my research for Reanimators, the novel, I did the same thing for Derleth's work. And as a side project, I slapped that together as a small volume that you can go through and figure out exactly when certain things happened in Derleth's universe. And it's completely... What you realize when you do this, and I think Rick would back me up on this, is that Derleth's universe does not mesh with Lovecraft's.
I'd be surprised if it did.
There are contradictions and things just don't happen. Lovecraft is an actual character, actual person in Derleth's universe, as opposed to, you know, being the creator. But working for the timeline with Derleth's works.
I sent this to Steve Santiago. Go ahead, Rick. I'm sorry.
Ken Zane's mouth, you know, was a real event, and Lovecraft fictionalized it. And if you read his stories carefully, you'll get little discrepancies with what Lovecraft wrote, like Captain Marshall out of a different first name. Mm-hmm. The month that the feds raided the town is different in a couple of stories. So he begins to deliberately deviate from Lovecraft.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Well, I sent The Lurking Chronology to Steve Santiago to do the cover for me, and two things about that. First thing, that I don't think you know this, Pete. He said, "What incredible work that Pete's done, and incredible amount of research." He was really impressed. And the second thing is that Pete and I were very impressed with the cover. That he gave us several different options, and the cover that Steve came up with is just beautiful. I think I shared that on the Facebook page once.
Yeah, it's stunning. I really love it. Cool.
It will.
Those great work.
Yes.
The other thing that looks like will be out at Necronomicon is Legacy of the Reanimator, an anthology of existing and new Reanimator stories.
Oh, we're on a go?
We're a go.
Because I'm in that.
You're in that, yep. Joe's in that.
Am I the last story?
No, you are not.
Oh, something even happened later?
Yeah. So...
And Casilda's Song, which also has a Steve Santiago cover, will debut at the convention.
That is a beautiful cover.
Yeah, he did a great job.
Steve started doing illustrations for Lovecraft eZine issues, like, I don't know, 3 years ago, maybe almost from the beginning, maybe even 4 years ago. And I think out of that, he's done a lot of book, starting to do a lot more book covers and everything, and he deserves the work because he's really, really good. He does a great job.
And Steve's also made posters of the Casilda song cover that'll be for sale.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
He's selling those online too, do you know?
Online as well, yeah. You can go to his Facebook page and he's got a link.
Okay. I'll have to remember to post that link then too, because
and Matt Carpenter.
I think we can all benefit from a Casilda song poster in our house. So.
Yeah. I want one, but then again, you know, I'm bent that way. There's a whole lot of things that'll be out for the convention. The thing Pete cooked up that one day on Facebook that Matt Carpenter ran with.
Oh, the
I don't know what the title, what the ultimately what they titled
Curious
that.
Curious and Lonely Country, I believe.
Curious and Lonely
Something
Country.
Like that, but that's finished and done, and that's supposed to be out. definitely Innsmouth. Nightmares, right? Yeah.
Yeah. If people don't know what Curious and Lonely Country is that, I guess three or four months ago, was it, Joe? I realized that a whole bunch of anthologies had just closed, and had left a lot of great stories as orphans. They weren't bad stories; they were just not picked up.
And these stories were crying.
You
could hear the tears. And,
so, you know, I put it out there that if you were an enterprising editor, you could pick up some great stories in an unthemed anthology and get it out in time for the convention. And, you know, cradled a grave in less than 4 months.
And they ran with it. Yeah. Matt and Sam did. So. Also, Autumn Cthulhu is coming out in October or November.
Right. Oh, Cthulhu Fatag and Ross Lockhart's new, you know, his Book of Cthulhu number 3, in essence.
Right.
That's supposed to be out, if I remember correctly. There's a lot.
Can I put in a word for a couple of things that I know are coming out by mid or the end of the year? One is Lynn Jamnek's all-female Lovecraft anthology. Tales from the Witch House, and the other one is Sylvia Moreno-Garcia and Paula R. Stiles's She Walks in Shadows, which again is all-female TOC, where we're specifically taking characters from Lovecraft stories, female characters from Lovecraft stories, and revisioning those stories from those women's points of view. And for that I did... Marceline Bedard de Rossi from Medusa's Coil.
Oh, nice.
It's a story called Hair Work. And I'm very, very proud of it. I was really, really happy to get that opportunity. Because let's face it, the monstrous feminine needs to be not quite overturned, but, you know, turned on its head, perhaps.
Gemma, I just saw a note from Bob Price. He is looking to put together an anthology of revisionist mythos stories.
Cool.
Which would fit with exactly what you've done.
Absolutely.
So,
I need to put that up on the page I have.
I'd love to do another one of those if I could.
Yeah. So. I think they're not due till November, so you've got time.
Cool.
Well, Joe, you were absolutely right about Langan and how long he would take. I don't want to get in trouble with Langan. And how great the story would be once I finally got it.
Wait a minute before you have Kung Fu Johnny kill my ass here.
It's
going to take forever. But there was a comma. And I also said, but it will be worth it. If there's anybody worth waiting for, it's him.
Well, what you don't know is that he didn't give me a short story for Autumn.
He gave you a novella.
He gave me a novella.
Yeah.
And his note said, well, you probably won't want this because of the novella, but, you know, you waited so long, you might as well should read it. You might as well read it.
So let me get this straight.
I'd say this all made me very happy because it made me not the longest person and also not the longest story.
You weren't anywhere near the longest person, relatively speaking, because I asked you later on.
Mm.
What were you going to say, Pete?
So I just want to get this straight. You ask for a story, and I whip something out in a day, and you say, yeah, that's okay, that'll work. And then you wait months.
No, 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 that's not what to bitch about here, Pete.
Okay.
What I want to bitch about is this is just another occasion where you get the fucking guidelines, and it said 5,000 words, and when I was at 5,345, I then spent 2 weeks to get it down under 5,000.
I didn't tell you to do that. I did not tell you
but
to do
that. But then any old Yahoo out there could come along and, you know, at the 11th hour, oh, hey, it's a novella, man. Well, and Mike would go, thanks, this is the greatest thing I ever read.
Right. I felt sorry for him, you know. I thought, you know, he worked so hard on it.
Just because the guy's a goddamn brilliant writer and half genius doesn't mean you suck up to him like that. Christ.
So,
you know, some of us actually pay attention to editors' guidelines.
So just to be clear, the book is a few stories up front, and then the novella, and then a few stories in the back.
No, I think I have yet to decide that. I was thinking I was going to put the novella at the back.
All right.
Don't you think that makes more sense?
I think you should, like, break it up into parts and parse it through.
Yeah, four parts. You put one in the first quarter of the book, one in the second. You know,
why don't I just hide a word in each of your stories? Why don't I just hide, like, a paragraph?
That's what I was thinking.
Like the bracketing structure of an anthology film.
Yeah.
And I'll be a millionaire next year. People will go, that was brilliant. How did he get it?
Well, you know what? Maybe the thing to do is, because he couldn't follow guidelines and he was late, maybe save that story for Autumn Cthulhu number two.
No, I just said I wasn't going to pay him.
So. Well, that works too, because, you know, you could give...
No,
well, I could use a few extra bucks, so, you know, he doesn't need it. He's got all his glory, for Christ's sakes.
So, Joe, on that note, I will say this. I have been approached, not by the publisher, but by other people, to try and put together a Legacy of the Reanimator Volume 2. Because I need to read that again.
Yeah, you do. You might want to familiarize yourself with it, with that Reanimator mythology.
If you're going to do that, you ought to get Gemma to do something for you.
Well, keep me in mind.
Yeah.
I'm on Facebook.
I don't know. You know, once again, I will say, I don't know how I got labeled the Reanimator guy.
So I don't know how you did that.
Write a book called Reanimators.
That might be one way. Yeah.
These people, they're like librarians. They need to figure out where to put us.
You're
Mr. Reanimator. I'm the King in Yellow. Yeah. It doesn't matter you've done other things.
No.
They're irrelevant.
You know, the sad thing is, I originally wanted to call the book Shadows Out of Arkham. That's, you know, that's what I wanted. But
yeah, it's like me. My wife's like, you're just obsessed with Batman and Superman all the time, and everybody thinks of me as the Lovecraft guy. I get all the Lovecraft questions, and I think of myself as the Batman guy, you know. So.
But the problem is, Pete, there's been so many Shadows and so many Arkhams.
Yes, I know.
It's like, if you're going to do the mythos, you got to find a Nick that hasn't been done to death. You can't write a constant, like, I find it difficult for anybody, though, like, as Stanley Sargent did it pretty well, writing Innsmouth story after Innsmouth story.
Right.
But Stan didn't do Innsmouth story after Innsmouth story. And in actuality, outside of the Crypt of Cthulhu, most people haven't seen most of Stan's Jeb and Martin stories.
I know, but he had a pretty decent series.
Yeah, but
at least five or six Innsmouth.
You're just seeing the tip of the iceberg with them, because he's never wanted to put them out there. You know, there's a handful of us who read them privately, but, you know, they were never published.
Yeah.
You know, he thought they were too slight. They're little comedy pieces. Nobody wants to read that.
Well, yeah, a tadpole from, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. There was a couple of Shaggy Dog stories. All right, what else do we need to talk about? I gotta walk.
Wait a minute, one thing before I forget, and then go ahead, Rick. there's a book out there that a lot of people have said some really good things about, called The House of Hollow Wounds, and it needs more Amazon reviews. So
it needs sales.
Yeah, sales too would be nice, but for Joe, but Amazon reviews do help with sales. I think I read that somewhere. So
I certainly hope so.
Yeah, they do. They influence people buying this. So,
are you aware that it's going to be a sequel to Cthulhu Wars?
No, I did not know that.
Kickstarter hasn't officially started yet, as far as, but it's going to be called Cthulhu Wars Onslaught 2. And it's going to somebody different than Richard Luong is doing the art.
Since I haven't gotten the $250 worth of Kickstarter bonuses yet.
Well, I think he's coming out. Was that one of the things I read on the internet? He was coming out. Was it? So he's all these supplements are just going to be like fill the pre-orders, and it won't be anything redone afterwards. He wants to have more money to put the supplements out.
I had one question while I have all of you guys on the line, because this, you know, I've been sitting here for 2 hours now, and this literature world that you guys are all a part of is totally alien, in every way.
You're
a bunch of freaks.
What I wanted to ask, if each one of you can give me one recommendation for a novel, an anthology that I should pick up. I want to get one recommendation
for Lovecraft.
It could be something that lives in a kind of dark fantasy Lovecraft world that's not necessarily something that I would just know, you know, offhand based on its popularity. You know, if somebody was going to start entering these circles that you guys are in, because I am a total outsider when it comes to this.
Okay. Yeah. I'll give you two things that they're on opposite ends of the spectrum.
That's fine.
One was edited by Ross Lockhart. It's called The Book of Cthulhu. You get the first one, and if you know, there's another one, but start with the first one. And Ellen Datlow did something called Lovecraft Unbound.
Yeah,
that one. And I think they're two of the they're quite different in their own capacities. They'll give you the widest breadth of what we term Lovecraftian or cosmic horror. It's a good pairing to start. There's a lot of other really worthy things, but
right.
That's where I'd start with contemporary, more contemporary stuff.
Mm-hmm. I've got one. You mentioned that you might not know about or wasn't too popular. Greg Kuhn's definitely carving out a niche, but Deep Night by Greg is a really, really good book that I think meets the requirements of what you're talking about.
Right.
So.
And it's sense it's kind of looking for inspiration. People who are interested in cosmic horror, interested in Lovecraft, you know, seeing what people are, how they're modernizing, or maybe not modernizing, how they're working.
All right. If we're going to nail it down to single authors, then you need anyone. I don't know anyone. You need one of Neil Laird Baron's collections.
Yeah.
Absolutely. If you haven't read Laird Baron, you know, just close your door, lock it, close your blinds, and don't bother with the subject anymore. he's doing amazing work with cosmic horror. He's just
awesome.
And
I don't know if you know Caitlin Kernan, Caitlin R. Kernan.
I do, and I don't know why.
Okay.
The
two books of hers that I would really recommend would be The Red Tree and The Drowning Girl.
Okay, The Drowning, okay, that's why I know her.
Yes, yeah.
But Drowning Girl is just, also, yeah, go ahead.
Actually, both of them were just optioned for films. And she's writing the screenplay for The Drowning Girl, as I recall.
The Drowning Girl, I heard.
Yeah, so, you know, but they're both amazing. In terms of short fiction, I would try Libby Llewellyn, Engines of Desire, which is her first, and as far as I know, her only collection.
There's another one due early next year.
Good, good. I'm glad. And in terms of a person to seek out, she doesn't have a collection of her own, but there is a woman named Nadia Bulkin. She's amazing, and she's one of the best single new Lovecraftians that I can think of, and she's just amazing on every level.
She's going to be on Autumn Cthulhu too, Gemma.
Yeah, awesome. I know. I'm really, really glad to see you there. Nadia has a very big workload. She is still in school, and the stuff that she's doing under that workload makes me want to, you know, tie her down and crack her head and eat her brain.
Yeah, she did a thing based on repair of reputations for Casilda song. I found mine.
I wanted to read that anyways, but yeah, I totally want to read that.
And just to jump off from something that Gemma said is, for those that don't know, Casilda song is, the table of contents is all female. And it's based, of course, on Robert Chambers' King in Yellow Works.
Yeah.
Nadia's in my top 10 people when I want to invite people. She's utterly amazing.
Awesome. Thank you for the recommendations, by the way.
One novel that I would not have read if not for Joe, and Ramsey Campbell recently endorsed it, is The 47th Mandela.
Really underrated. Unbelievably underrated. Laidlaw's sort of like Gemma to me. Somebody, I don't understand why everybody's not reading these people. It just, you know, I can pull out this, I can pull out that, and it's home run after home run after home run, and I don't get it. Are you reading just past the time, or are you reading because you love the written word? And if you love the written word, you know, these are people that I don't understand why, you know, you're not running to get their work.
Yeah, Joe had told me about The 37th Mandela several months back. I went and bought the book. He nagged me to read it. I read it. I really liked it. And then I sent an email to Ramsey Campbell a week or two back, and I said, can you give me just a short list of your Lovecraftian recommendations, you know, not written by Lovecraft, and that was one of the novels that he recommended.
Daryl Gregory's novella, We Are All Completely Fine, has a beautiful divergence on some of Lovecraft's themes, and it's just a gorgeous little piece generally. It's about an encounter group for people who have essentially survived horror movie backgrounds.
I wrote a story. That's so bizarre. I wrote a story of the same thing. It was called We're All Completely Fucked.
Well, there you go.
It was very similar.
Another guy that I'd point you towards is Scott Nicolay.
Yeah, Anatok Guides on God is a great book.
Yeah.
Joe mentioned Laird Barron. I like everything that Laird writes, but if you're looking for novels, his novel The Croning is, I think, my favorite novel of his.
I think it's the only novel he's written so far.
Yeah, so it's the only one that's in print.
I was thinking there's another one, but yeah, The Light is the Darkness is a novel.
Yeah,
that's true.
Yeah, I knew there was another one.
It's certainly the only one that has a physical form.
What short story is it? Is it the Imago sequence that has Broadsword in it?
No, that's Occultation. The Broadsword is...
Okay, that's where I'd start, Occultation. Which I think is his first... No, Imago was his first one. Occultation was his second.
Let me, before we can continue or quit or whatever it is we're going to do, let me just tell the people that are watching, if you want to win one of those three prizes, send me an email. Not to the regular email address, please. but to lovecraftezine prizes@gmail.com, lovecraftezineprizes@gmail.com. And very important in the subject of the email, please put which prize you're going for. Matt's given away those two books. The Jeff Thomas book, what was it, 121? Is that right?
Subject 11?
Subject 11. That 121 got stuck in my mind. I haven't read Subject 11 yet. And that is a great prize because that's a limited edition signed, I believe, mm-hmm. he said. And then that steampunk book, you don't have to get the titles right. Just put what you want in the subject. The steampunk Lovecraftian book, if he was here, I'd ask him the title again, but his computer was active.
Tears of a Mad God.
Tears of a Mad God. Thank you, Pete. And Subject 11, and then if you want that Cthulhu, cool-looking Cthulhu bank, which people who have bought it tells me that it's really cool, put that in the subject. Just makes it easier for me when I'm using random.org to pick the prizes. And I will also, I just posted the email address on the message board. So anyway, getting back to recommendations, Pete has a recommendation, but just let me say again, based on just talking with you the last 2 hours, Len, I think you would enjoy this novel. So.
I'll take a look. There was one thing I wanted to share with you. I'm not giving it away. I completely forgot to show you. But we were at a film festival 2 weeks ago. We won the award for best sci-fi film. And right. These are the awards that they give out. I think you'll get a kick out of it. Let's see if I can get it on here. It is a very heavy and dangerously sharp statue clutching the earth in his palm. Nice. I don't know if you can
see it. And it's dangerous.
I just want to be a filmmaker so I can win that.
Yeah, it weighs about 10 pounds. It could do some serious damage.
But wait a minute. That's the award?
That's the award, yeah.
Where was this?
It was crafted by the guys, or at least cast by the guys who do the Emmys, so it's a real, actual metal statue.
Oh, my God. Wow.
Just sits staring at me on my desk.
That's awesome. And congratulations, by the way.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. So. I should get a kick out of it.
No, I see a lot of short films are sent to me. People are like, are you aware of this Lovecraftian short film and so forth? And there's some good ones out there, but there's a lot of crappy ones out there. I put yours in the top 5% of all the ones I've seen the last 5-10 years.
Thank you, Mike.
So, I mean, very high-quality short film. Really, really is.
Try to bring
Let's put it to you this way. Every short Lovecraftian short film I see, I don't immediately email the director and say, you want to make a short film?
Well, thanks, man. I appreciate that. I'll try to bring you something longer next time.
I look forward to it.
Yeah.
Okay, we need to talk. Bring up anything else before we're done here?
Thank you. This has been really, really nice.
Oh, thank you for being on the show. It's been great talking with you.
The one thing I wanted to mention, in case anybody, because it hasn't been widely reported, is that Jeff Rice died.
Creator of Cold Check, the Night Stalker.
Oh, I was trying to think of how do I know that name.
Yeah.
So.
That's sad.
Yeah, it is. Essentially, he gave us the X-Files 20 years earlier.
Yeah, it is. It's exactly like that.
So, yeah, Chris Carter was very, said repeatedly that he was, that's what inspired him to create the X-Files. Was Kolchak the Night Stalker. And we've talked about that show many times here on this show. You know, it's what a great show it is. Please check out Gemma Files books. Just go to, I guess, the easiest way. I'm sure there's other ways, but go to Amazon and type in Gemma Files. Or what's your website, Gemma?
Oh, unfortunately, my pro site is not very well kept up. So
better just go to Amazon and type in your name?
Yeah, going to Amazon, but better yet, go to eZine Publications. Okay. CHIZINE Publications. And they have their own website, and they have everything that's available for me. I took a look at Amazon, and they are actually a couple behind.
Okay, that's great to know.
And also, my first collections of short fiction have been picked up as ebooks and are being re-released through CZP. So okay, it'll be so easy to find that way.
CHIZINE.com.
No, just look under CHIZINE publications.
Okay, Google
like,
that.
Google those two words, and whatever comes up, it's probably CZP.com, but I'm not absolutely sure.
Okay. I'm glad I asked them, because that sounds like that's a better and more complete way to get your work. Going along the lines here, and then we'll be done. Joe Pulver's got two new books out, House of Hollow Wounds and The King in Yellow Tails. Mm-hmm. So please check those out. We're doing pretty well with I'm the publisher on The King in Yellow Tails, so I know that for a small press, we're doing pretty well with sales and reviews, which anyone can see, but I also can see that House of Hollow Wounds deserves more reviews on Amazon. So please, if you've read the book, help Joe out in that regard. All of us can use that, publishers, editors,
authors, because everyone in the small press, absolutely.
Yeah, because people go to Amazon, if they're on Amazon, and they're like, do I want to buy this book? Do other people like this book? And they see one review, it's kind of a maybe if they don't know anymore. But they see some good reviews on there, and they make that decision. So obviously don't write anything you don't feel to be true, but if you've read the book and like it, please review it. So, and then Pete's got Legacy of the Reanimator coming up, and at some point in the future, a porno book called Reanimatrix, I believe.
Reanimatrix.
Yeah.
It's, well, I can't say that it's not porn.
Did you see my tweet last week where I wrote about the book I'm publishing for you, the Larking Chronology? I said, here's a nice surprise regarding Pete Rolick. It's totally not porn.
I just...
Own it, Pete. Own it.
I'm going to own it. I wrote it. There are
I'm not saying anything he didn't say. I'm just following along. So.
There are some explicit scenes, chapters. My female character is very... Passionate. Thank you.
Yeah.
And she doesn't mind writing it down. There's nothing wrong with reanimated zombie sex. Or
and I don't want to be the one that says there is anything wrong with that.
I don't see anything wrong with the Deep Ones brothel. Okay?
No. Who would... Wait.
Wait, what? Rick, do you have anything coming up besides your story and Legacy of the Reanimator?
I'm just in Legacy of the Reanimator.
Okay.
I'll have some pulp book coming out eventually, but I don't have a date for it.
Do you have a name for it?
Well, they're calling it Rick Lay's Major Sabbath, even though I've only wrote one of four stories in it.
Okay.
But it's the selling value that your name has. This is why they're doing that.
Which I feel is negligible, but I don't know. That was the publisher. That was Ron Fortier's decision.
Oh, so. I had to tell you guys a story. I walked into my local comic book shop and looking for a copy of Providence number 2 by Alan Moore, and they didn't have it. And the guy kind of looked at me and like, don't I know you from someplace? And he's like, yeah, you do the eZine chat. You're Pete Rolick.
Well, he knows you from that. I thought you were going to say Reanimator.
And he says, I just finished Reanimator and Weird Company. When's your next book coming out?
You see the power of this show, don't you?
Meanwhile, I've been a customer at the store for 25 years.
Yeah, but it's always when they see you somewhere else that you suddenly ring a bell.
That's almost as good as Joe's story when he was at a convention and somebody told him, you're my favorite character on that eZine show.
Yeah, the last Necronomicon, Providence, yep. Oh, you're Joe Pulver. Hi, I like your books. You're my favorite character on the Sunday night chat. I wish there was royalties or residuals or whatever the hell they call them.
Yeah.
I need an IMDb listing for this.
There were certain characters.
How come I don't have a listing for that?
What, Rick?
There were certain characters that make shows. It's just like Happy Days didn't get off on its legs until the Fonz got introduced.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, you know, Joe is our Fonz.
Or Kramer, you could say.
Lord help me.
Kramer of Lovecraft.
Kramer Pulver.
Look, that hair is Lovecraftian. Just own it.
All I know is when Joe's not on the show, I get emails from people going, "Where's Joe?" You know.
Well, then that's normally Joe is sick in bed. You know.
No, I know that, and I know you. And for everybody watching, Joe has been really, really sick. But I just want you to know that the people watching miss you when you're not here. So.
And meanwhile, if Pete's not on the show, they're like, "Oh, thank God that Rollick guy's not on the show tonight."
No, I mentioned it because Joe hasn't been here for a couple of weeks. But anyway, Gemma and Len, thank you so much for being on the show, and you know, hopefully you guys can come on again sometime. And we will see everybody next week. So thanks for watching.